Today, in this problem, we're going to use the corollary to Taylor's theorem to classify the stationary points of a function, in this case, a polynomial degree 7, just to give us something of interest to use. The question asks us to verify that these two points are stationary points and classify them. So the first thing we need to do is evaluate the derivative at these points. Well, I've written the derivative down, so save us having to go through that calculation. So we want to actually evaluate the derivative. Well, given this for the derivative, well, evaluating the polynomial at 1 is easy, just sum the coefficients. And if you sum the coefficients in this one, you quite easily get 0. And then you've got to evaluate the polynomial at minus 2. It's a bit more complicated. Use Maple, Mathematica, your calculator, synthetic division, whatever method you happen to have been taught. And if you do that, you again find that f dashed at minus 2 is also 0. So this is confirming that 1 and minus 2 are stationary points, the derivative vanishes. To actually classify the type of stationary points, we need to calculate the values of higher derivatives. So we'll look at the second derivative. I'm not going to write the second derivative down. But once we do, again, evaluating at 1 is easy, just sum the coefficients, and eventually you find that that's 0. And then you do the same thing for minus 2. Again, that's quite a bit more work, but after enough calculations, you find the second derivative of minus 2 is also 0. So we have to go on again. We have to calculate the next derivative up. Well, we calculate the third derivative at 1, and we find that it's not 0. In fact, from memory, it's a negative number. But the important point here is that it's an odd derivative, and it's not 0. Now, that tells me that 1 is an inflection point. So now we have to calculate the third derivative at minus 2, and in fact we find that the third derivative at minus 2 is 0, so we have to keep going on again. We calculate the fourth derivative at minus 2, and that turns out to be not 0, and in fact it turns out to be minus 648, or something like that. The important point here is that it's negative. I mean, you can do enough of the calculation to convince yourself it's negative, and that would be enough. And if the fourth derivative is non-zero and the value is negative, that tells us we've got a maximum. So we have an inflection point at 1 and a maximum at minus 2. We can now go on to actually graph the function. It's always a good idea to graph the function, get Maple or whatever program you happen to want to do to graph the function. And as you look at the graph, you can see, yep, there's the maximum at minus 2, but it looks very flat there. It's a very sort of flat maximum in a sense because we've had to go up to the fourth derivative to find the actual value because the first three derivatives are 0 there, but it's still clearly a maximum. And we've got an inflection point at 1, which again you can see quite easily on the graph. Okay, now in this second part we're going to look at yet another polynomial and again classify its stationary points. So here we have once again a 7-degree polynomial and we're asked to verify that minus 1, 2 and 3 are stationary points and then classify them, again using the corollary to Taylor's theorem. So rather than write down the actual polynomial and its derivatives, I'm just going to create a little table here of all the appropriate values. So the first thing we need to know is that they are stationary points. We need to know that the derivatives vanish there. Well, in fact, that's what we do. We differentiate this polynomial here and get whatever we get. We evaluate at minus 1, which is just, we just take an alternating sum of the coefficients, positive, negative, and so on. And when we do that for this particular polynomial, we indeed get 0, showing us that minus 1 is a stationary point. And then we do the same thing at 2 and 3, and we again get 0. So derivative vanishing verifies that they're stationary points. So the next thing we want to do is to calculate the second derivative and evaluate that. Well, write down the second derivative of this polynomial, put it into Maple or whatever, and find the values. You find that the second derivative at minus 1 is again 0, but the second derivative at 2 turns out to be 54, not 0, and the second derivative at 3 turns out to be, what's positive, it's 122. So this is telling us that since it's an even derivative that's not 0 first, that tells us we've got a maximum or a minimum, and because we've got positive numbers here, that tells us that what we have are minima. So these are two minima. Right. But we've still not got round to classifying minus 1. So we have to calculate the next derivative along. Well, when we do that, we find the third derivative, shove in minus 1. We get something not 0. What the actual value is doesn't actually matter now, because not 0 and third derivative tells us we must have an inflection point. So we have an inflection point and two minima, one at 2 and one at 3. And again, we plot the graph here. And if we look at the graph, we can clearly see, yep, there's the inflection point at minus 1 and the two minima at 2 and 3, with a maximum in between them. There must be a maximum between these two minima. That follows from the stuff you did in first year on things like Rolle's theorem and the mean value theorem.